Hello everybody, welcome to chemistry tutorial. So this is our second lecture on the organic chemistry and our topic was reaction mechanism, and today we will discuss about the elimination reactions. In the first lecture I have covered the substitution nucleophilic reactions and the condition where substitution will occur or the elimination will occur. Now in this video I will be discussing about the elimination reactions. So without a further ado, I am going to start the basic mechanisms of elimination reactions. Now elimination reaction are of mainly three types. One is your E1 elimination, second one is your E2 elimination, and third one is your E1CB elimination. We'll discuss each and every one by one. Now for E1 elimination, this is similar to, you can think like that SN1 kind of reaction, where suppose a substrate is there where the leaving group is X. In the first step, this carbon and the bond between the carbon and the leaving group is getting broken, and you are getting a carbocation like this. And in the second step, what you can think that the hydrogen present in the adjacent carbon, it will be eliminated with the help of some base which will abstract that hydrogen, and you are getting the product like this. This kind of alkene is formed. So this is the basic mechanism of E1 reaction, and that is why the tertiary alkyl halide is the best candidate for the E1 elimination, then the secondary alkyl halide and the primary alkyl halide. Okay. And the primary alkyl halide practically give no E1 elimination. So this is a basic mechanism, and from this mechanism what we can see that carbocation formation is important. Carbocation formation occurs and the carbocation stability should be higher in order to give the E1 reaction mechanism. Now this E1 stands for the unimolecular. So it is basically the unimolecular. Why it is unimolecular? Because over here the first step, which is basically the breaking of this carbon and the bond between the carbon and the leaving group, so this is occurring in the first step, which is the rate determining step. So the rate depends solely on the concentration of the substrate. So it is a unimolecular reaction mechanism, and that is a one stands for unimolecular reaction. Now second point is that here the RX or R leaving group, okay, this is the leaving group, basically you can think that this bond is getting cleaved. So if the leaving ability of this group increases, that will basically increase the rate of the elimination reaction or the rate of the E1 elimination reaction. Clear? So these are the some important points which we need to discuss about the E1 reactions. But one more important thing is that not all tertiary alkyl halide give E1 elimination. If I see this example over here, this is a tertiary carbon, it is also tertiary alkyl halide, but here E1 elimination is not possible. In order to do the E1 elimination, we have to clip this bond. Okay, this bond should be broken, and as a result of that, what we will get, we'll get a carbocation in this position, and from this structure it is quite clear that this position or this carbocation is not stable, because if you remember the Bredt's rule, which I have already discussed, Bredt's rule, what it says that in this bridgehead position, this is basically the bridgehead position, this kind of molecule are called the bridging molecule. And this CH2, you can think that it is a bridging carbon. So this ring junction, two carbons present in this ring junctions are called the bridgehead carbon. So this bridgehead carbon does not allow any carbocation or double bond. Clear? So this carbocation is not stable, and if the adjacent hydrogen is removed to produce a double bond over here, that will basically form this kind of compound, which is also not stable due to the presence of the double bond in the bridgehead, including the bridgehead carbon. Clear? So due to the Bredt's rule, in spite of being a tertiary alkyl halide, it will not give the reaction. Okay, now we will discuss about the E2 elimination reaction. For E2 elimination reaction, what I can say that base is attacking this kind of assembly, okay, where base is abstracting hydrogen over here, and this will form a double bond and the leaving group will be removed. So as a result of that, we will get a alkene like this, and the point is that it is a single step reaction. So it involves the concentration of the base as well as the concentration of the substrate, so it is a bimolecular. So it is a single step concerted process. Now, since it is a single step reaction, this is the only step which governs the rate of the reaction. Now, in this case, this carbon hydrogen bond is getting broken. So the strength of the carbon hydrogen bond is important. Suppose I am giving you one substrate where this hydrogen is substituted by a isotope like deuterium. Suppose I am taking this substrate. Over here, base will attack this deuterium and that will form the same product. Okay, same product will be obtained. But over here, the CD bond is to be broken. Now, if you compare the bond strength, CD bond has higher bond strength as compared to CH bond. That is why the rate of this second reaction will be slower. This rate will be slower. So when hydrogen to deuterium substitution occurs, this kind of substitution is often referred to as the isotopic substitution. Okay, so when isotopic substitution is occurring, that will decrease the rate of the reaction. Clear? So this is called your primary kinetic isotope effect. Okay, so this is observed in the E2 reaction mechanism. Okay, now we will discuss our third type of elimination reaction, which is basically the E1CB reaction mechanism. In order to discuss about the E1CB reaction mechanism, we will take a substrate like this. Now, in this case, what we can see that when base is applied, the base will abstract the most acidic proton. Okay, so this is the function of base, most acidic proton. Now, over here, what we can see that there are two hydrogen that can be abstracted. Now, between these two, hydrogen, if you consider this hydrogen, if we remove this hydrogen and form a conjugate base over here, suppose I am abstracting this hydrogen and a conjugate base is formed over here, so that will produce a negative charge in this position, and that is stabilized with the help of this NO2. You know the structure of NO2. NO2 has a structure like this. Okay, if negative charge is there, that will be resonance stabilized. So it is basically the minus R group, and also the electronegativity of nitrogen is greater than the electronegativity of carbon. That is why it is operating the minus I effect. So it is basically a strong electron withdrawing group. Since it is a very strong electron withdrawing group, so this negative charge stabilized over here. So this kind of conjugate base is stable. So there will be the formation of the conjugate base of the substrate. This CB stands for the conjugate base. When the conjugate base of the substrate is producing due to the presence of very highly acidic hydrogen at a suitable position over here. So in this kind of reaction mechanism is called the E1CB reaction mechanism. Now in the next step is obviously the formation of double bond over here and the removal of this methoxy. Now methoxy is not a good leaving group, but over here the stability of the product actually governs the removal of this methoxy group. Okay, and thereby the producing this kind of product. And this double bond is not only resonance stabilized with this nitro group, but also it is resonance stabilized with this fluorine. So this will be our product, eliminated product. So this kind of mechanism is called the E1CB reaction mechanism. We can see that the application of the E1CB reaction mechanism is the deprotection of FMOG group. FMOG group means basically it is a fluorinyl compound. Fluorinyl group, okay. Fluorinyl group. The deprotection of this FMOG group. Now, if we consider this RNH2, amine, primary amine, it can be protected by different groups. Now, one of them groups, you know that one of the common protecting group is Bok protection, okay. Like Bok protection, FMOG is also another protecting group of this NH2. Now, if you draw the structure of this group, you will see that I am drawing the structure of this molecule. RNH over here, CO. In this case, there is a fluorinyl group. This is the structure of this group. Okay. Now, this FMOG group can be deprotected with the help of base. So, if I apply base can deprotect this FMOG, thereby it can produce the primary amine. So, what will be the reaction mechanism? Suppose I am treating this moiety with some base. Base could be your sodium ethoxide. Okay, you can take it as a base. Or potassium tertiary butoxide you can take. Now, over here, the base has a function to abstract the most acidic proton. If you consider this molecular structure, this position has a hydrogen which is the most acidic hydrogen. So, the base will abstract this hydrogen, thereby producing a negative charge over here. If it produces a negative charge, now this negative charge will form a double bond and this will be broken. So, here what you can see that first the conjugate base has been formed and after that the elimination of this part is occurring. This part, this overall part is getting eliminated. So, you can think that it is a formation of this kind of situation. Plus, over here a double bond is there and this benzene ring. Okay, fluorinyl group will be removed in this way. So, this is basically considering the following the E1CB reaction mechanism. Now, over here this negative charge will come back and it will be like this. RNH minus plus CO2. CO2 being a gas is removed from the system. Now, after workup, you will get the primary amine. This is the basic of the E1CB reaction mechanism. So, I think this is more than enough for your exam preparation. So, these are some basic mechanisms for elimination reactions. We have discussed so far the E1, E2 and E1CB reaction. And in my previous video, I have discussed the SN1, SN2 and SN9. So, these are more or less complete discussion about the important topics of substitution and elimination reactions. Now, in the next video, I will be discussing about the NGP. Okay, you will get video on NGP, which is itself a very important from your NET and GATE point of view. So, that's all for today. Thank you. Happy learning.